Okay, this week, this is what, the 13th week? We're going to talk about, we're in chapter on chapter 15, emotions, aggression, and stress. This is really a fascinating chapter. Well, it is for me anyway. I don't know how you guys feel about it. Anyway, okay, emotions, aggression, and stress. Emotions have four aspects. They have feelings, there are actions behind our emotions, there are physiological arousal that takes place, and motivational programs that happen to us when we display emotions. Actions include emotions. With actions, emotions often trigger action and are intensified by the presence of the feelings. Facial expressions are also demonstrative to others and may act as a warning mechanism. This is what other animals do. The reality is this is what humans do, and this is one of the reasons why we are face watchers. We're trying to determine whether what somebody is saying is dangerous or whether it's not dangerous. Now, that's an extreme situation. We really want to know if somebody's happy or not happy. We want to know if they're depressed. We want to know what their feelings are, what their real feelings are. And we can usually read that in somebody's facial expressions. When somebody is depressed, one of the aspects of depression is that the individual has a blank stare. They'll have a blank expression on their face. That signifies depression. And the reason it signifies depression is because a person's feeling sad. So why don't they walk around with a sad look on their face all the time? And the answer is because it takes too many muscles of the face. So they almost look like, and I hate to use this expression, but they almost look like somebody who has died and who have no expression on their face. But you will see a blank look on a person who has died, their face. You guys have never seen anybody like that, but that was part of my job, of course. Lucky me. Intensity. Emotions tend to have intensities from low to high. So if it's a happy emotion, happiness to joy to ecstasy, if it's feelings of affection, it would start off with regard. Then it would move to affection, and then it would move to adoration. Fear starts off with apprehension, and then there's fear, and then eventually that emotion can turn into terror. Surprise starts off with distraction, and then it moves to surprise, and then amazement, of course. Sadness, pensiveness starts off with pensiveness, and then sadness, and then, of course, grief. Disgust starts off with boredom, then it moves to disgust, then it moves to loathing. Anger starts off with annoyance, moves into anger, and then eventually it moves into rage. Expectation starts off with alertness, and then it moves to expectation and then vigilance, of course. Reading literature pre-20th century, it was fairly obvious that folk psychology felt that the feelings caused the physical reaction. So if you have a feeling, it causes a physical reaction in you. The feelings are first, and the physical reaction is second. But at the around the 20th, the beginning of the 20th century, there was a psychologist at Harvard named William James, and there was a psychologist in Sweden named Carl Lang, and they came up with a new idea. James and Lang believed that the feelings were a reaction to the physical changes. Thus, fleeing from an enemy causes fear and smiling causes happiness. So according to this theory, if you want to be happy, if you want to be happy for the rest of your life, smile. Create the feeling just by having the physical reaction or showing the physical reaction. James and Lang were aware that often there is a delay in feelings after the physiological response, and that's how they came up with the James-Lang theory. Cannon and Bard, research by Walter Cannon and Philip Bard, refuted the James Lang theory. Cannon and Bard discovered that the experience of the emotion started before the autonomic changes. Not only that, but often the autonomic changes are identical for different emotions, readying the individual for flight or fight. Cannon and Bard felt that it was the cerebral cortex's responsibility to find the appropriate emotion to fit the circumstances. Work by Stanley Schachter showed that both theories are correct in select circumstances and incorrect in select circumstances. Schachter injected individuals with epinephrine, the hormone secreted in the fight or flight response, which made individuals react emotionally. And of course, this proved the James Lang theory. So you could inject them with epinephrine, and they would have an emotional reaction because they had the fight or flight hormone in their system. And this proved the James Lang theory. But in some in the same circumstances, if a Confederate acted with a select emotion in the presence of the individual displayed the bogus emotion. So they injected them with epinephrine, and if somebody was sad around them, that they would feel sad, and that proves the Cannon-Bard theory. And of course, these are emotions, and you're supposed to identify the emotions. Number one, concerned. Number two, that's the happy baby, happy. Number three, you can see his teeth, and anytime you can see somebody's teeth, they're either smiling or they're probably angry, and this individual's angry. Number four is a fake smile, and I will explain a fake smile in just a minute. Number five, he is angry. He is enraged. Number six, I can't remember what that one is. Number six is pondering, I think, maybe. Number seven is disgusted. Number eight is scared. Number nine is concerned. Number 10 is surprised. Number 11 is surprised as well. Number 12 is geez. She's got an idea in her head anyway. We won't go into what it is. Number 13 is bored. Number 14, this is really kind of interesting. When I was working up in Montana on the Fort Belknap Reservation, people used to talk about women snapping their eyes at people. And that's what she's doing. She's snapping her eyes at people. She's showing them that she's not happy about something. And she is proving that by not looking at them, but moving her eyes over to look at them. So she's not actually moving her head, and that is known as snapping your eyes. I thought that was kind of a curious one. Okay, this is an actress by the name of Dawn French. And if we look at these two pictures, she's smiling in both pictures. But the reality is she's actually only smiling in one picture. And the picture that she's actually smiling in is number 15. Number 16 is a fake smile. Now, how do we know that 15 is real? It's real because we can see her crinkling her eyes. And when you're really happy and your face is making a smile, then it crinkles up your eyes. If it's a fake smile, of course, those muscles, you can see her cheeks are nice and high when she's really smiling. This one, not so much. Her mouth is not moving up in a real smile, and so her eyes are not affected by her fake smile. Number 17 is happy. Number 18 is curious, I think is the definition. Okay. Facial expressions. There are seven facial expressions that are recognized in almost all cultures around the world. Anger, sadness, happiness, fear, disgust, surprise, and contempt. And I'm going to show them to you right now, I think.
Mm-hmm. It's 9 o'clock on a Saturday. A regular crowd shuffles in. There's an old man sitting next to me, making love to his tonic and gin. John at the bar is a friend of mine. He gets me my drinks for free. And he's quick with a joke or to light up your smoke. But there's some place that he'd rather be. He says, Bill, I believe this is killing me. As a smile ran away from his face. Well, I'm sure that I could be a movie star. If I could get out of this place, oh la 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 la. Now Paul is a real estate novelist who never had time for a wife, and he's talking with David, who's still in the Navy. And probably will be for life. And the waitress is practicing politics as the businessmen slowly get stoned. Yes, they're sharing a drink they call loneliness, but it's better than drinking alone.
Okay, there you go. How about that? Let's take a look at, let's learn how to read body language. This ought to be interesting. He goes kind of fast, but that's okay.
Well, hello, Internet. Welcome to my presentation on gestures and body language. KellyB23 wrote me and asked, do you know how to read gestures and body language? If so, teach me. In this presentation, I will do just that. What I did was I studied over 25 psychology and law enforcement training manuals. I discovered what they all agreed with and put it all into this one presentation. I want to start off first with the eyes. A person's eyes dilate strongly when they are very stimulated and in a problem-solving mode. At maximum dilation, the person is ready to make a decision, which is most likely going to be positive. An eyebrow raise is a sign that a person isn't threatening. When you actually raise your eyebrows to somebody, even if they're a complete stranger, they'll often smile. This is a very submissive sign, or at least is perceived that way. Whenever you first meet somebody, the first person to look away is considered to be the most submissive. If a person is maintaining strong eye contact, they are either 1. Interested in you if their eyes are dilated, or challenging you if their eyes are constricted. The most threatening look is achieved by moving narrowed eyes towards a person with little to no body movement. The speed of this head movement will demonstrate how angry that person is. Liars maintain strong eye contact with people. It should actually become uncomfortable at some point. If someone gives you a sideways glance, look at their eyebrows. If they're raised, they like you. If not, they don't. If a person's blink rate increases, this is considered a sure sign of lying. If a person's eyes are darting around, they're either getting bored or nervous. When first meeting a person, shake hands with strong eye contact and then give them at least 3 seconds to look at you uninterrupted to generate the best rapport. To build strong rapport, you should look them in the eyes somewhere between 60 to 70% of the time. This is a really interesting chart. A lot of people don't know this, but whenever people are trying to remember something, they'll look in certain directions. So, for example, if a person looks upwards and to your right, they're trying to remember something they visually saw. And if they look sideways and to the right, they're trying to remember something they heard. Down and to the right is whenever a person is talking to themselves. And if they're either trying to construct something that they've never seen, or they're planning on lying to you, they'll look up and to the left. Down and to the left is where a person looks whenever they're feeling something or remembering an action. You might be asking yourself, or you might be thinking to yourself right now, well, I just feel more comfortable with my arms crossed in front of me, for example, or some other. What you have to understand is if you feel comfortable with a specific body position, it is because you're feeling a certain way. Ask yourself, for example, when would you feel comfortable with your arms crossed while enjoying yourself with a loved one? Or even better yet, have you ever seen anyone cross their arms in excitement? Now on to handshaking. When shaking someone's hand, if their hand is on top, they're trying to dominate you, which means that they literally take your hand and flip it so that your palm is facing towards the ceiling. Also, if they grip it like a vice, that also means they're trying to dominate you. An equal handshake in which both people shake in a vertical manner with equal pressure is the best way to generate good rapport. Do not shake with both hands or touch any other part of the body unless you have an intimate relationship with this person. At most, a brief touch to the elbow, which is considered a non-intimate part of the body, during a handshake has been shown to generate very good feelings and generate very good rapport. A valuable clue to whether a person is being open and honest is whether they're showing their palms or not. So to elaborate, honesty equals palm displays. If a person says they can't do something and they show you their hands, they're telling you the truth. And what's better yet, if you talk with a lot of palm displays, you'll actually force the people you're talking to be more truthful. Hands clenched in front of a person means they're holding back a negative reaction. Holding one's wrist behind their back is an attempt at self-control. And if a person places their head on their open hands as if on a platter, they're saying that they admire you. This, by the way, is the best body position if you want to attract people to yourself. If a person's picking imaginary lint, they have a secret opinion more than likely that they don't want to tell you. Hands folded in front, hand in hand, shows that you are feeling vulnerable. Pointing at a person is one of the most annoying gestures. You should also never rub your thumb to your forefinger around people. This is considered the symbol for money. Rubbing the hands together shows that you are expecting something positive, and it has been shown that the speed at which a person rubs their hands will demonstrate how good they expect the results to be. The steeple hand gesture represents that you are confident and self-assured. This gesture should be used sparingly. However, if you want to guarantee a look of confidence, this is the look. By pressing your forefinger to your thumb, you will come off as authoritative but not aggressive. What I mean by this is, instead of pointing with one finger, instead, take your pointer finger, place it on your thumb, and point in that way instead. You'll actually see President Obama do this very often. Holding hands behind your back shows that you're confident, but you feel superior. The reason why is you're exposing all the delicate parts of your body, being the groin, stomach, and throat all at the same time. Hands on hips show that you're preparing to dominate unless the elbows are held close to the body. In this case, it would be a submissive position. If a person tucks their thumbs in their pants rather than rest their hands on their hips, they're being very aggressive. Thumbs protruding from pockets shows that the person feels they're superior to you. We fold our arms in front of ourselves when we feel either threatened, don't like, or trust something. When you fold your arms, you lose credibility with people. If you're folding your arms while grasping your biceps, it shows that you're feeling very insecure. If you clench your fists while folding your arms, people will see you as being hostile. And arms crossed with thumbs turned up shows that a person is warming up to you. Now I'd like to go into invisible walls. A woman will often create an invisible wall with a purse by placing that purse between them and the person that they do not trust. If a person puts a drink on the opposite side of the hand in which they're drinking, that also creates an invisible wall because they have to continually keep reaching across their chest to get the drink. You can gain a lot of information by studying people's legs. The reason why is information you gain by studying leg and feet positions is extremely useful because people have little control over them. This is why most meetings feel only comfortable if two people have their legs hidden by a table or desk. If you want to appear young and vibrant, you should always walk quickly while swinging your arms. Also, it has been shown that people's feet will point towards that which they want. Always offer people a hot cup of coffee. The hotter, the better. This makes it difficult to remain crossed up without burning themselves. I know this is kind of sadistic, but... Another tip to get a person to unlock themselves is to ask them positive questions that get them to tell you what they're feeling. Never cross your legs and then have both hands cradled behind your head. This is an extremely off-putting, especially to women. Here are some additional negative leg positions. Jiggling of the feet is a sign that the person wants to get away from a situation. Open and uncrossed legs show you are prepared to dominate, while cross legs show that you're closed off or uncertain. If legs are crossed, the knee points towards that which you prefer, and you should never ask a person to make a decision if their legs and arms are both crossed at the same time. If a person has their legs crossed, then they're holding them in place with their hands. They are feeling very stubborn. And a person that locks their ankles together is essentially biting their lip. If a person locks one foot around their calf or thigh, they're showing signs of timidness. And if a person sits oddly in a chair, they're showing that they don't see you as being important. If, however, they flip the chair around and place the back of the chair towards you, they're using the back of the chair as a shield and again plan on dominating you or strongly disagree with what you're saying. Here are some positive leg positions. Women specifically cross and uncross their legs around people that they like. More specifically, they cross their legs in a parallel manner when they really like someone. If as you speak to somebody that one of their feet continually keeps moving closer and closer to you, that means that they are feeling a strong connection. You can check to see that a smile is sincere by checking for wrinkles at the eyes. If you smile at a person, they will return the favor more than likely. And people that smile a lot often will receive very positive reactions from others. When a person is smiling, they're often more likely to be telling the truth as well. And a false smile will often appear stronger on one side of the face versus the other. Tight-lipped smiles, on the other hand, in which teeth are not shown, tell you that the person is trying to keep a secret. And a smile in which the person has their head turned down and their eyes aimed upward is used to show that the person is attracted to you. Laughing is very attractive and makes you as well as others feel comfortable. Laughter has more to do with bonding than humor, though, however. And as many people know, yawning is used by people to build rapport and avoid aggression. Well, that's the end of the presentation. Hope you liked it. If you have any questions or you have a question you'd like me to research, leave it in the comment section below. Till next time.
Wow, that was fast. Wow, he talks pretty quickly, doesn't he? Okay. Sorry. Okay, facial expressions are created by two sets of facial muscles, the superficial facial muscles and the deep facial muscles. The superficial facial muscles change the shape of the mouth, the eyes, or nose and pull on their attached skin. The frontalis muscle wrinkles the forehead and raises the eyebrows. Deep facial muscles are attached to the skeletal structures of the head. They enable the individual to chew. The masseter is the powerful jaw muscle. It attaches here. It attaches at the jawline, and it is actually attached to the top of the head. Human facial muscles are innervated by the two cranial nerves. The V2 innervates the superficial muscles of the facial expression, and the trigeminal nerve innervates muscles that move the jaw. Right and left nerves are completely independent, allowing the person to wink and crinkle one corner of their mouth. Bell's palsy is caused by an irritation of the nerves on one side of the head of your face. Depending where the Bell's palsy originates, just a small portion of the entire side of the face can be affected. Dental work often causes the problem, but the condition is rarely permanent. Actually, it kind of looks like they've had a stroke. Bell's palsy. They can't really move their faces. When I was in the service. A real young guy, he was relatively young, had dental work done, and he had Bell's palsy for about 2 months. It was really weird talking to somebody who was as young as he was, and it looked like half of his face was paralyzed. It wasn't really. He could do things with it. He couldn't move it as he normally did or as he normally would. Through studies with animals and emotionally disturbed humans, researchers discovered an area of the brain that deals with emotion. And this area is known as the limbic system. It's in the center of your brain, and it seems to control emotion. The limbic system includes the basal forebrain nuclei, the mammillary body, the olfactory bulb, the amygdala, the hippocampus, the parahippocampal gyrus, the cingulate gyrus, the anterior nucleus of the dorsal thalamus. And all of these are, I don't have my arrow. All of these are here. Studies using electrodes implanted in the brain have discovered that most areas of the brain do not produce positive reactions. However, positive brain sites do seem to be concentrated in the hypothalamus. The most apparent area is a large tract that ascends from the midbrain to the hypothalamus, a region referred to as the medial forebrain bundle. This area seems to have something to do with food-seeking behavior in lower animals.
but not especially in humans.
Physicians have noted the differences of people with localized cerebrovascular accidents, those are strokes or hemorrhages in the brain, to emotional reactions. A stroke in the right parietal or temporal lobe causes undue cheerfulness or choking or joking, denial of illness, and apathy. That's on the right parietal area or the temporal lobe. So it would, I can't show anything. Strokes in the left frontal lobe, especially in the basal ganglia area, can cause depressed mood, daily mood variation, loss of energy, anxiety, restlessness, worry, weight loss, decreased appetite, early morning awakening, delayed sleep onset, social withdrawal, and irritability. And of course, this the red area on the picture on the left is what we're talking about. That's your frontal lobe, and that is your around your basal ganglia. Well, who knows how deep it goes. Bilateral hemispheric lesions or any lesions in the brain can cause frequent brief laughing and or crying. Crying that is not caused by sadness. Social withdrawal secondary to emotional outbursts. And that's what a lesion looks like. It's actually an area that is, the area has died. And it has caused a open spot. And that's what a lesion is. Strokes in the right basotemporal or right orbitofrontal region can cause elevated moods, increased energy, increased appetite, decreased sleep, feelings of well-being, pressured speech, flight of ideas, and grandiose thoughts. So it kind of sounds like you've got bipolar disorder. Studies looking at the fear response in animals and humans have discovered that the amygdala, part of what used to be called the reptilian brain, is the structure that mediates fear. And of course, the amygdala are the red portions on both of the pictures. Pictures of fear-inducing images shown to individuals will elicit blood flow to the amygdala. When a woman without an amygdala was shown a picture of a woman smiling, she recognized it. Her expression is happy. When the same woman was shown a picture of a woman registering fear, she didn't recognize the emotion. It wasn't extreme enough. And she didn't have an amygdala. Researchers looking at aggression have discovered that cross-species elevated androgens means elevated aggressive tendencies. Androgens, of course, are steroids like testosterone. Supporting evidence, when a male subject species is castrated, androgens and aggression both drop. Injecting testosterone into the castrated individual leads to increased aggression. In a study looking at this is fascinating. In a study looking at female prisoners, it was found that women in prison for unprovoked violence had higher testosterone levels than women in prison for defensive aggression. Similar results were found with veterans showing antisocial behavior. So individuals who are violent, who have violent ideas, that's what unprovoked violence means. Whether they're male or female, they will have higher testosterone levels. Studies of monkeys and lowered levels of serotonin show that there is a negative correlation between serotonin and aggressive behavior. The lower the serotonin, the more aggressive the individual is. And of course, this has something to do with your hypothalamus. Your hypothalamus creates your sex drive. So the more testosterone you have, the stronger your sex drive, whether you're male or female. But one of the things that we have noted is that serotonin controls aggressive behavior. It actually negates the amount of testosterone that you have in your system. Now, the interesting thing may be, or is, or seems to be to me anyway, that if we look at all the humans around the world, one of the things we're going to discover is that those individuals have about the same testosterone level. So they're about the same level of aggressiveness. Now, this may have something to do with, you know, and this may have something to do with the fact that when we talk about people that live in rural areas as being more macho or more masculine, and it may have something to do with the fact that when you live in those areas, of course, you're more challenged to survive. Survival is closer to the surface. So you may have a higher testosterone level because of those circumstances than somebody that lives in a city where they don't have survival isn't in question ever. And this may be one of the reasons why we talk about things like metrosexuals. A metrosexual is a non-aggressive male who lives in the city. There was a television show about that 5 or 6 years ago. It was called Men in Trees. This woman from New York went out to Alaska with a friend for something. I can't remember what the premise was. But when she got there, she realized that she was sexually attracted to the men in Alaska. And the reason was because they were more masculine. And they kept complaining about metrosexuals in New York City, men who actually do things with their fingernails and put on makeup and make sure their hair is correct all the time. Whereas country people, of course, they don't really care. They don't care how, they don't care nearly as much how they smell, as long as they don't stink too much. Anyway, it's just a curiosity. It was a television show, so you don't have to take that one to the bank. But you know, this has always confused me. My daughter wanted to, we raised the kids primarily in where were we? Texas, then Germany, and then Nebraska. And then we went out to California for a year, and then we came back to Nebraska. So we raised them mostly in Nebraska. Well, Nebraska is, of course, a farming community. It's fairly relatively rural. We lived in a small town on the Missouri River, just south of Omaha, because the reason we went to Nebraska is because we were in the military, and I was stationed at Offutt. That was my last assignment, was Offutt, and my wife was there as well. So we raised the kids in Nebraska, and it's, like I said, it's a fairly rural community full of fairly macho individuals. So my daughter decided she didn't like it there. She decided she would move. She moved to Phoenix first. Then she got in the military, or she was working for the military. They shipped her over to Germany. She came back to Lackland. She came back to Virginia. And then she decided to move to Florida. And one of her complaints about Florida was that the men were, she said, "Dad, they're not very masculine down here." And of course, the problem was it was such an urban area. She lived in Boca Raton, and so she was always complaining that the men, she wasn't attracted to the men because they weren't very masculine. But then she's moved to Iowa, and she's a lot happier. Not because the people are more like the way they were when she was growing up in Nebraska. And of course, Iowa's a farming community as well. And people just exude their personalities. And you know, it's down in Florida, they were so superficial, she felt. Anyway, just an aside, curious aside. Serotonin is not the only neurotransmitter that controls aggression. Hormones that control testosterone levels and the GABA system also play a role. Now we're going to talk about immunity. And this is really interesting to me because this is what I did when I was working in the hospital. I was a laboratory technician. And one of the things that I was given the chance to do was to read blood smears. I read blood smears. And of course, it has a ton to do with your... Let me see if I can get this thing to work. Wait a second. I'm going the wrong direction. I'm trying to get the arrow to work so I can point these things out. Let me do this. Okay. There we go. Okay, I've got an arrow. Okay, I'm going to show you all this stuff. And this is one of the things I used to do, looking at a normal blood smear. And so what we would do, we would get a percentage of what kind of white cells or leukocytes that we were looking at. Your immune system is based on the type of white cells that wander around in your blood. And the reason you need these is to take out all the foreign bodies like bacteria and viruses, allergens, cancers, things that are growing that shouldn't be there, heavy metals that might be in your system. So each cell has its own job. Not every cell can fight everything. I mean, you wouldn't want that. They're more specific than that. So these are the leukocytes. These are the five different leukocytes. Basophils, and the reason they have these strange names is because it has to do with the stain that they absorb. Some cells absorb a lot of stain, and some cells don't absorb very much stain. I know it sounds weird, but they were trying to figure out how in the world can we read somebody's blood smear, and the answer was, well, we will stain it with blue stain and orange stain. I think that's about it. It's blue and orange primarily. Anyway, so basophils absorb heavy metals when they find it. And this is what a basophil looks like. There's two of them in this picture. Those two up here are basophils. And basophils, of course, absorb a lot of the purple stain, and that's why they're so dark. Okay. Eosinophils will combat allergens. So if you are allergic to, pinon, pollen, or whatever, then you'll have a lot of these orange ones. And eosin is actually a stain, so they call them eosinophils because they absorb a lot of the orange stain. And you'll see some of these. If somebody has a parasite, eosinophils will produce eosinophils to try to take care of that parasite. So we can actually tell whether you have you've been around heavy metals like lead or they used to put lead in gasoline. So we used to see a lot of basophils. We don't so much anymore because they don't put lead in gasoline anymore. It was too toxic. But if you sneeze a lot in the springtime and sneeze a lot and blow your nose a lot in the fall, then we would probably see these. Or if we thought that you had worms, if we thought you had worms, then we would see a lot of these eosinophils, the orange ones, which is kind of cool because all the rest of them look like this. You got all these red cells, and then you've got a lot of these and a lot of these. A lot of these and a lot of these. Okay. Lymphocytes fight viruses, and these are what lymphocytes look like. So most of your immune system, and the ones we talk about, we've got coronavirus wandering around all over the United States. Yesterday we had the highest number of positives that we had ever detected, I think over 120 million. No, that's not right. 120,000 positives yesterday. Jeez, 120 million, my goodness. That's a third of the population. It's a virus, and so is the flu. The flu's a virus, so is mononucleosis. If you come down with mononucleosis, we see a lot of these guys right here. These are lymphocytes. Normally, you'll have maybe 40% of your white cells will be lymphocytes. But if you have an infection, of course, these will explode. You'll just get tons and tons of these guys. Now, normally, most of the cells in your blood, most of the white cells, look like this. These are neutrophils. And the reason they're called neutrophils is because they don't really absorb very much of the stain at all. As you can see, the nucleus does, absorbs the purple stain, but it's not like the eosinophil where it absorbs a lot of eosin. Once upon a time, we had to stain these by hand. Now we have machines that can do it, that will do it. But if we make a blood smear, we used to have to do it by hand. And if we left it in too long, in the eosin too long, then all the cells would look like this. But they weren't. They were neutrophils. And
you'll have anywhere from 50 to 75% of your cells will be neutrophils. Now, if you had a bacterial infection, the neutrophils would be 80, 90%, like if you had an appendicitis. And it's one of the ways that we can diagnose an appendicitis is if we draw the blood and the white cell count is high, somewhere between 15 and 20,000 per mil, I think. Anyway, I can't really remember what that is, but we would see a lot of these guys. The more neutrophils we saw, the more we would realize that the individual probably had an appendicitis, and we would probably see immature forms of this cell, which looks a lot like this. Well, actually, it looks a lot like that. So if we saw a neutrophil, you can see this has a blue cytoplasm, and this one has a pink one. If we saw this structure with this color of cytoplasm, we would know that it was a immature neutrophil. And then the last type is this type right down here. These are monocytes. These are a little bit bigger than the lymphocytes. They look an awful lot alike, and people get these mixed up because an abnormal or a immature lymphocyte looks like this. So we see a lot of immature forms of this. This is what an older lymphocyte looks like. As you can see, the cytoplasm, the larger the cytoplasm, the younger it is. These are older lymphocytes. So if you see a lot of older lymphocytes, it really means that you haven't had a viral infection for an extended length of time. The monocytes are phagocytic. They will engulf something, and they're looking for cancers. So we have all of these different white cells, and each one is looking for something different, which is a good thing because there's viruses out there, there's bacteria all over the place, and of course there's allergens out there all the time. Most of us are not allergic to most of us don't have asthma, most of us don't have allergies, but some people do. My daughter does. My daughter has allergies. And if we were around a lot of aviation fuel, it does have lead in it. It does have, and we would potentially have an increase of these. And actually, okay, so I was in the Air Force. When I was in the Air Force, we had to draw the refuelers. We had to draw them every month to make sure that they didn't have an increase of basophils. And that's what we were looking for. We were trying to determine if they were getting, if they were somehow absorbing gasoline through their skin, or if they were just, they were getting too much of it into their system. And if they were, of course, they would have to move them off of doing what they were doing, because otherwise they would poison them. Okay. The immune system is very adaptive and maintains itself through several structures. And normally we don't have to worry about this. You know, the flu season hits. Most people fight it off. They don't have to worry about it. They come in contact with it. Their immune system defeats it. And, you know, everybody's happy. One of the reasons that the coronavirus is devastating the United States and around the world, actually, it's hitting us a lot harder than it is hitting anybody else. The reason it's so bad here is because we haven't done anything about it. If you have been listening to the news, then you know that Europe is locking down again because they're having another surge. We're having the same surge that they are, but we're not locking down. It has become a political football, but unfortunately, of course, we're going to lose a lot more people. Right now, we've lost almost 240,000 people. Let me get my 240,000 people. And the reason that we're having so much trouble with it is because, I mean, you know, you come in contact with rhinitis, with colds all the time, rhinoviruses, you know, the Hanta virus is out there. We had the Zika virus about 5 years ago, 6 years ago. We get flus all over the place. But the reason the coronavirus is doing so much damage is because it's the novel coronavirus. So nobody has immunity. theoretically, nobody has immunity, but I have a feeling I have immunity because, well, I worked in the lab, and I came in contact with anything that came along. And I actually came in contact with a coronavirus back in the 80s. So potentially, I am immune to I'm immune to the coronavirus. But, you know, maybe not. We're having lots and lots of trouble with the coronavirus in Iowa right now. We are exploding. We are really surging in this state for some reason. Anyway, so I want you to think of this like, geez, normally I get one cold a winter, and now I've got to worry about the coronavirus. Am I going to get sick this year? And the answer is you probably won't catch the flu, but you might catch the coronavirus. The immune system is very adaptive, and it maintains itself through several structures. And this is what we've been waiting for. We've been waiting for our immune systems to be able to fight this thing off all by themselves. People are testing positive, but they're not having any symptoms. And that may have that, and we're not exactly sure why. Why in the world didn't Trump get sicker? Why did he only spend 2 days in the hospital? And we really don't have an answer for that. In his case, we gave him immunoglobulins, Regeron or something like that. Anyway, it was monoclonal antibodies. So we gave him extra antibodies running through his body. Normally, we have these running through our bodies anyway, and we don't have to do anything about it. The B lymphocytes comprise the humoral immune system. These cells are produced in the long bones, and so they're produced down here. The B lymphocytes. The B cells produce antibodies or immunoglobulins that either directly neutralize the antigens of the foreign body or enhance the destruction by other cells. So the three important immune areas are actually the lungs are one of the most important areas. But the thymus, which is right behind your heart. Here's your spleen. I don't have one. I lost it in a soccer game. But it's on your left side, right under your rib cage, and your humerus bones, the bones the long bones of your thigh. Cell-mediated immunity involves lymphocytes formed or converted in the thymus behind the heart. There are three kinds of T cells, T helper cells that produce interleukin and lymphokines. T killer cells and T suppressor cells, which suppress humoral reactions. Now you wonder, why in the world do we need a suppressor cell? The answer is that sometimes our immune systems become overactive. As a matter of fact, if you've been studying and listening to what's going on with the coronavirus, you realize that the people that are dying from coronavirus, one of the reasons they're dying is because they have an overreaction to the virus. So once it gets down into their lungs overreact and produce too much mucus to try to protect themselves. So they're having an overreaction to the coronavirus. As it turns out, and this is something that is really kind of shocking, but as it turns out, people with a select type of blood are more likely to have an overreaction to anything. And that type of blood is type A blood. There are four basic types of blood. There's A, B, AB, and then there's O. Most people are O have O type blood. So the people with A type blood are the ones that are having overreactions, unfortunately, as sad as that is. And that's one of the reasons why you need suppressor cells to suppress the humoral reaction to an infection. Otherwise, if you got a cold, and you know that nobody has ever done any research with this because your blood type has to do with your racial makeup, with your DNA. So they don't want to talk about this kind of stuff. But the reality is, and in the future, of course, this may become more and more important. But the reality is that people with A-type blood have different immune systems. They're stronger, and so they're more likely to have an overreaction. And that's why you need the T suppressor cells. Now, luckily, I have type O blood, and type O blood reacts the least aggressively to an infection like this. So you would think somebody with type A blood, and now that this cat's out of the bag, one of the things we may be looking at in the future is how long do people have colds? So if you catch the flu, how long did you have it? If you have type O blood, the flu may only last 4 or 5 days. If you have type A blood, the flu may last 7 to 10 days. Now, why is that? It's because you're overreacting. The reality is that you blow your nose, you catch the cold, you don't feel very good, you're kind of sick for a couple days, and then you just blow your nose for 3 or 4 days. What is that nose blowing thing going on? Why do you have so much mucus in your sinuses and maybe down in your lungs where you're coughing up phlegm and whatnot? Why do you have that? And the answer is that your body's trying to protect you. It's trying to protect you, and the way that your sinuses, that your mucous membranes protect themselves, is by producing mucus. Now, normally they just keep everything nice and wet with mucus, and that's okay. You blow your nose in the morning, maybe you blow your nose in the evening, everything's hunky-dory, everybody's happy. But then, of course, you catch a cold, and all of a sudden, you have the cold for a couple days, you knock the thing out with your immune system, and then you have an overreaction, and that's why you blow your nose so much. Which is kind of curious, which is a good way to do things. But in order to keep your immune system from going berserk, from overreacting to something, that is what the T suppressor cells do. And now we know, of course, that people with type A blood are more susceptible to prolonged viral infections because they overreact to it. They were only sick for the first 2 days or the first 3 days. That's what the fever and the chills and the muscle aches are all about. Is if you're not having fever and chills and muscle aches, but you have all that sinus reaction to the disease, that's probably just an overreaction to the disease. And it's a good thing, because if we didn't have any reaction to it, then it would just run rampant through our system and kill us. So we do need the overreaction, and that's okay. But unfortunately, in this case, it's causing people to need to go on ventilators, and sometimes they're not recovering. We're doing a lot better job. We don't have nearly as many deaths as we did before, because our medical teams are doing a much better job of fighting off the disease. Before we were, that's where steroids come in. What we were doing before, we were just ventilating the people. They were having their overreaction, and then they died because we couldn't control it. But now, of course, we put them on a ventilator and we give them steroids at the same time. Why do we give them steroids? Because steroids suppress your immune system, and we don't want people to overly react to the infection. I know, isn't this really kind of fascinating? And before, we didn't even think about this kind of stuff. There were some people that were dealing with this, but most people they didn't even think about it. Even doctors, they weren't even thinking about it until we had, 240,000 people die from coronavirus. Now we think about it, and now I imagine this is all going to become part of the protocol. They will type your blood, and they will try to determine if you have an overreaction to an infection, as exciting as that is. Besides B and T cells, a major leukocyte in circulation is a cell that does not require an antigen to trigger the immune response. And this is known as the natural killer cell, or the NK cell. It is a free-floating granular lymphocyte that recognizes stressed or alien cells and destroys them without the antigen-antibody connection. This cell is produced in besides the thymus or the bone marrow, the spleen, and the tonsils. Now, I told you before, I don't have a spleen. So you would think I get sick all the time. As a matter of fact, they keep giving me shots, telling me that I need a shot to keep from getting this disease or that disease. The reality is that I don't get sick. I never get sick. I don't catch colds. I don't catch the flu. I haven't caught the coronavirus yet. Of course, nobody around me has had the coronavirus. But I don't have a spleen, and that makes me immunocompromised. Theoretically, I'm immunocompromised. But I have a theory, and my theory is that I've got lots of these guys, these natural killer cells, wandering through my blood. If you come in contact with, let's say you come in contact with the flu, it comes in, you know, you get it on your hands and you lick your hands, and now you've got the flu. Now you've got the flu in your system. The virus is, wants to spread. Now, for you, because you have a spleen, it serves as a repository for the natural killer cells. So they sit there, and as soon as there is something to kill, then they will go out and try to kill it. But by this time, you've already had the flu for a couple days. Now me, I don't have that. I don't have a spleen, so it has no place to sit. And I don't have tonsils either. I had my tonsils taken out when I was 20. I had my spleen taken out when 1985. So when was that? When I was 30. 1985. I was in my 30s. I was born 49. So I was 36 when I had my spleen taken out. When I lost my spleen in a soccer game, and that's another story. Anyway, so my theory is I got these guys floating around my system, just all over my system, and it knocks out the disease before it has a chance to take hold, because these guys have to do something. So I've got all these natural killer cells. While most of the leukocytes circulating in the body are granulocytes, various organs will act as staging areas or modification areas in case of a viral invasion. The spleen is a major staging and modification organ in the body, the spleen. And like I said, I don't have that. So what's going to happen next? The spleen normally contains 40% of the NK cells, 25% of the B cells, and 10% of the T cells. 40% of the T cells and 40% of the B cells are located in the lymph nodes for rapid modification. The lungs are a major staging area for lymphocytes, holding 35% of the NK cells and 10% of the T cells, possibly to combat the respiratory viruses. And these are your lymph nodes. You've got lymph nodes all over the place. This is one of the reasons why if somebody gets lymphoma or they get breast cancer, they have to take out the lady's lymph nodes underneath her armpit. And the reason they have to do that is because the lymph nodes, it's a circulatory system. And since it's a circulatory system, if they allow the cancer to get into the lymph nodes, then it will potentially spread all over her body. And of course, now she's got a real problem. What are they going to do for her? How are they going to take out her? How are they going to take the cancer out of her system? So if we were talking about the two major areas for lymphocytes, it would have to be the spleen and the lungs are the two major areas. During times of stress, the immune system is suppressed. While on the surface, this may not make sense, one must remember that the immune system marshals a great deal of resources. While in a fight or die situation, death will occur if the organism does not marshal all of its resources to survive the encounter. Thus, we need to suppress the immune system. Immune system takes a lot out of us. Normally, every day, as long as you're not stressed, your immune system is working very strongly, and it's taking a lot of your resources. But if you're under stress, then your immune system is suppressed, and a lot of times you will get a disease of adaptation. People under a great deal of stress over a long period of time are more susceptible to select infections, such as fatigue, muscle wasting, hypertension, ulcers, loss of libido, suppression of ovulation / impotency, and accelerated aging. Psychology and medicine have melded at various times since the advent of psychology. Medical doctors are very aware that some people may think that they are sick, but actually aren't. This problem is known as a psychosomatic condition, and the medicine dealing with it is referred to as psychosomatic medicine. Health psychology is the field of how psychology may influence good health. Psychoneuroimmunology studies the immune system and its interaction with the nervous system and human behavior. And that is the end of the chapter. Okay, well, I will get the quiz up, and I'll talk to you guys next week. Stay safe, please. And if you have type A blood, stay away from people with coronavirus. You guys probably don't know what type blood you have. But that's what I did when I was in the service. I typed people's blood.